Okay. Good evening. Welcome, everyone, and a very special word of welcome to our distinguished guests, writer Sasha Stanisic and the translator of his book Herkunft, Herkomst, Annemarie Vlaming. Sasha, drago mi je da si ti večeras naš gost. Čestitam ti na Evropskoj nagradi za literaturu. Želim ti ugodno večer. We are so pleased and honored to have the both of you here tonight at this festive evening prior to the European Literature Prize ceremony for Herkomst that will take place tomorrow evening at the Crossing Border Festival. If you have no tickets for that event, don't bother, it's sold out, so tonight will be the night. First of all, I would like to introduce Sasha Stanisic to you. His novel Herkunft received a lot of attention and critical acclaim. It was the winner of the Deutsche Buchpreis in 2019. It is his third novel. Previously, he wrote the novels Hoe de Soldaat de Grammofoon Repareert, uiteraard in het Nederlands vertaald, and Nacht voor het Feest. Herkomst is a novel that is, in the author's own words, about the first coincidence in our biography about being born somewhere. In the case of Sasha Stanisic being born in Visegrad in 1978 in what is now Bosnia and Herzegovina, then still in Yugoslavia. In 1992, because of the war, the flight and the departure of his family to Germany took place. Tonight we are going to talk with the author, who in Die Welt has been named one of our best storytellers, about this autobiographical book, and with his, in her own words, loyal and faithful translator, Annemarie Vlaming, who also translated his other books and has so excellently translated this book, which is just as shimmering, whirling, witty as it is melancholy and painful. So great to be able to welcome you both, Sasha and Annemarie, and of course, congratulations to the both of you on winning the European Literature Prize 2021. This European Literature Prize is an initiative of Academic Cultural Center SPUI 25, and we are here now, the Dutch Foundation for Literature, weekly magazine De Groene Amsterdammer and Atheneum Bookshop very nearby, and is supported by the Lira Foundation. So a lot of people thought it is important to have this prize. The jury of the European Literature Prize consisted of translator Martine Wout, who translated one of last year's winning books, booksellers Marieke Groot, sitting next to Sasha, and Mariska Verbeek, also bookseller, and writers and essayist Cyril Offermans, who is not present here this evening, and I myself. And I had a very special honor and pleasure of being the chair of this jury. Now, without further ado, I will first read the report made by the jury. After this, Marieke de Groot and I will have a conversation with Annemarie and Sasha. And after that, there's time for a short Q&A. And please bear in mind that the English language is not our mother tongue. And then we will all cheerfully find our way to the drinks. Oh. The jury report, European Literature Prize 2021. There's no getting around it. 2021 has turned out to be the year in which the importance of translation and translations and the role of interpreters and translators have become more prominent than ever, especially now with Europe sometimes conspicuous by its absence from the world stage. It's essential to maintain strong links between the countries of the old continent and to keep attention focused on free movement back and forth from one language to another. Translators are indispensable in this regard, enabling us to gain understanding and continue to garner knowledge of each other's histories, backgrounds, and lives from a social, historical and cultural point of view. The jury of the European Literature Prize, I already mentioned whom it was consisted of, selected a short list of 5 impressive novels from the long list. After that, the jury found itself with quite a challenge, how to choose between the singing innovative Meisje, Vrouw, Anders by Bernardine Evaristo, refreshingly translated by Lette Vos, the deeply human and painful De Reparatie van de Wereld by Slobodan Schneider, in an excellent translation by Roel Schuit, the overwhelming and epoch-spanning De Jaren by Annie Ernaux, in the erudite translation by Rokus Hofstede, the landscape novel Langs de Rivier by Esther Kinski, sublimely translated by Josephine Reinaerts, and you understand that we all warmly recommend all these books to be read by you, and of course The Astonishing Herkomst by Sasha Stanisic, translated with perfect fluidity by Annemarie Vlaming. In an animated Zoom meeting, because we all lived in the corona year together, the jury members entered into debate and arrived at a decision to award the prize to Herkomst by Sasha Stanisic on the following grounds. Herkomst, Where You Come From, the third novel by Sasha Stanisic, born in Visegrad in 1978, is a melancholy and at the same time irresistible, optimistic, tender book. As the son of a Bosnian and, on paper at least, Muslim mother and Serbian father in the former Yugoslavia, Stanisic cheers for the diverse Red Star team 1 year and the next flees to Germany at the age of 14. There he grows up in a migrant community, falls in love, both with a girl and with words, and stays. He is embarrassed by the bare walls and third-hand furniture of the home allocated to his family and by their customs. By embracing his native language alongside German and with it his parents, he frees himself from that initial embarrassment. When he applies to become a German citizen, he is asked about his origins, a construct, the author calls the concept, but it is a construct over which he takes back control in this autobiographical novel. The jury was touched by the precise, playful search for whatever it is that constitutes the essence of our identity, for what origin really amounts to. It repeatedly turns out to be found in the connection between people, in the connection with language, and in the great and moving ability of people again and again to attach themselves, to reach back, to reconnect, and to bind to the present, not without pain and great efforts of will, a past that has become detached from it, along with the loved ones to be found there in this past. An important part of the origin described in Stanisic's book is his beloved grandmother Christina, who stayed in Visegrad when the Yugoslav wars broke out. As she is pulled deeper into the past by dementia, Stanisic, now a father himself, realizes that part of his own past is disappearing with her. Stanisic follows the leaps of his grandmother's unfathomable memory and adds his own byways and digressions. He travels crisscross through his and his family's past, through meetings with distant relatives, detailed memories of those first few years in Germany, and his enthusiastic introductions to the power of language. Stanisic flits about in his material, supplements it with nostalgia and bitter irony, repeatedly wanders astray, expands, creates allegories, deploys myths, and takes the reader with him in stories that end very differently from the way they seemed to begin, like being born in a country that no longer exists. Stanisic rises above the forced platitude of a simple origin and effortlessly builds his own out of the people around him. Herkomst is both an affectionate and personal history, told from the perspective of a son and grandson, and the modern tragic European history that we must never forget. At the end, Stanisic intensifies all this into a compositionally strong authorial performance. Translator Annemarie Vlaming unfailingly conveys these leaps and this lightness from the German. Her love of language is undoubtedly as great as Stanisic's own. The astute plays on words and rapid, pointed, thoroughly unique use of language coincide effortlessly with the story, and the narration maintains its natural tone consistently in the Dutch. It's therefore with great pleasure that the jury decided to award the European Literature Prize 2021 to this book that we will now start to talk about on stage. And I would like to invite Marieke de Groot, who was a member of the jury. I already mentioned that. And of course, Annemarie Vlaming and Sascha. And now we will have a loose a setting and discussion about the book.
Welcome, and welcome all of you. First of all, congratulations, both of you. We spoke before Annemarie, when we announced the shortlist. Quite some months ago now, and then you had to wait a little and wait. What was it like to be nominated for this prize, or even better, to win it?
It was a big surprise for me, because I really thought that Evaristo would win the prize. Mm-hmm. And she thought that we would win the prize. Letta, the translator of Evaristo, thought that we would win the prize. It was exciting. But I also thought, oh, help, I don't have time for a prize.
You don't have time for a prize.
Because I have so much work to do.
You're so busy.
Yes.
Okay, I think we would all love to hear what you're translating and a brief summary of your career as a translator. How long have you been translating? Some highlights?
I started translating 18 years ago when I was pregnant with my daughter. And then it just continued. Every year, two or three books.
It just kept on coming.
Yeah. Sometimes you just have to wait for some months till the next book comes your way. But
how did you decide to become? Did you decide I wanna do it?
Yes, I studied German. I didn't want to be a teacher. I like children. But not in a classroom. I like working alone. I like being alone. So I thought, I like books. I love books. I love language. So that was the ideal career for me. It was not so easy to get the first job. I did all kind of jobs before. I worked as a postbode.
Mailman.
Yeah, mail woman.
Mail person.
Yeah. My husband was a mailman.
Did you meet
so
like that?
We meet. And then we moved together, and I got pregnant, and I started to translate, just like that.
And how did you get in touch with Sascha for the first time?
Oh,
and whose work?
Publisher asked me, "Would you like to translate the book, the first book, about a soldier?" So I just said yes, because you don't always have the choice.
Sometimes you just have to take what comes.
You have to take what I know. That sounds a bit, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
In the beginning, you just take a job you can get. But now I'm very happy with Sascha as my writer.
Yes, because you have translated all three books that you have published so far.
Yeah. Yeah. There's
I'm
one
trying
more.
To convince her to learn other languages so she can translate another two.
Oh, that would be great. I'd want 40, 50 languages.
And in your opinion, was the most exciting but maybe also difficult part of translating of this book, Herkomst?
Oh, that's
so
difficult.
What are special difficulties?
Maybe just things like the poems. Mm. because mm-hmm. all the other stuff, Sasha writes. I see the images, and I just write the images in Dutch. Maybe it sounds difficult, but for me it's not difficult because it just feels that I can look in his head.
You know what he means when he writes in German.
I think it helps that you have been doing it for a long time now. The 30
yes,
books and
it's experience as well, but also just know what he means. Mm. So we had all these poems from Eigendorf and Hölderlin, and translating poems is something else. It's not my job. So luckily there's other people who did that for me, mm-hmm. but there were some poems who weren't translated already. So I had to do that. That's something difficult. But all the jokes and the woordspelingen.
Did you ever had a strong difference of opinion?
No,
between
about
us?
Yeah.
He doesn't know what I'm doing.
Most of the time, she's just alone at home and does what she does. Yeah. So. But sometimes we do. We would. I think with the soldier, some questions were exchanged.
Yeah.
Before this book, actually too, I used to have a file on my computer. So mm-hmm. when the translator would come with questions, I would write the answers down, and then when next translator would come, I would already give pass the questions to that. So I don't know, but the fact is, the Dutch publishing house and Annemarie were always very fast. So most of the times when she was done mm-hmm. with the translating, she would be the first one. So there were no questions there. So she would kind of be the first. But mm-hmm. we never talked like in a fight or anything. That's just
I know the first book you. I got an email from you, and you said, I was waiting for your questions.
Yeah.
Where are your questions? All the other translations.
Everybody's asking questions.
I just don't have questions for you. I'm sorry.
I like questions.
Yes.
So there's a very, very a fluent way of translating.
Yes. I don't know how that works. It's a bit like you're my brother.
But it's actually nice because... some translators have, you know, you will get a mail, I have a few questions, and then you open the document and there are like 55 questions. And you're like, oh my God, when will I answer that? And most of them are basically already, the translator already knows what she or he wants to say, mm-hmm. but he wants to be sure. Mm-hmm. So it's basically questions which, this is how I would do it, what do you think about it? So I'm always, yeah, but do it. If you let me do it, I would always, so I think if you're sure of what you're doing, there's no need to ask me. So this is, I always consider translation to be an autonomous project and product of also aesthetical work. So why would you want to have my approval for that? I don't speak the language most of the times, and if I see a question which is already has an example of how it's translated, so where I can help is when there are historical or political questions. So I didn't really found anything about this protagonist, but this is a historical figure. Can you give me some more insights? That's something I like to help. So I would say, okay, listen, this is what I thought about it, and this is why I used it. But most of the aesthetical questions, I would actually rather leave it to the translators to decide.
Because in your case, it's a rather interesting process, because you, in a way, also added an extra language to your original mother tongue. And I wanted to ask a question about that, because I think it's give an extra layer to what you are writing. And you were 14 when you came to Germany. That's at an age when your mother tongue is already firmly rooted, and it's a language of your emotions and initial memories, etc. Was it very difficult to make the transgression as a writer to the German language?
Well, at the beginning, I was 14 when I came to Germany, and I remember that we never thought that we would stay long. We thought the war, why we had to leave, this will dissolve very soon and we will be able to go back. So at the beginning, in the first couple of months, we didn't even care for German language. Mm-hmm. I went to school 2 months after we came, or 1 month and a half, and it was like, oh, why do I have to do this? We're going to go home anyway. So it took a little bit of time to understand that we are staying, that we that the war is not going to end soon.
And when did you realize?
I think maybe 4 or 5 months into our stay in Germany. Already then I started going to school, and my parents had to work because we didn't have any money or anything. So at that moment, there was a kind of a sudden realization, not only that I need to learn the language, but also that I need to learn the language, that I really, that I'm... that it is everything about social life is depending on it. If I don't want to be an outsider, if I don't want to be considered only a refugee, the language is the entrance into this better world in the school or in the social neighborhood. So I started really actively then to learn. And I remember going to there was a woods in the next to our house, and I would climb into those stands for where people who observe animals would go up.
Uh-huh. Yeah, yeah.
So that was the only place I could find peace and quiet, because back at home, and I'm describing it in the book a little bit, there were so many people. There was always somebody coming, going, my family and all the other refugees, and you come home and they're like 5 crying children. You don't even know whose children they are. They're just on the floor. And then you have to imagine that you have to like learn vocabulary. There's no way. So I actually went to the woods and I would learn in German there. But and later on I would write in those little huts up there. In the first period of time I wrote still in Serbo-Croatian, and then there was a transition where I translated with the help of a teacher. And then maybe after a year and a half I already started to write in
already in a
German,
year and a half, just yes, very, very
but
quick.
Only poems actually, or mm-hmm. short, very short, like Kafka. Kafka is a really easy writer to
read
in, to understand. Mm-hmm. So I was trying to write parables like him, and I say after two and a half years I was basically not translating anymore, I was writing in German. And it didn't feel hard because I had so many stories that I wanted to tell, and I felt the language is only, you know, like a device for telling them, and I'm just using it. I'm not thinking about it too much. So there were many mistakes, of course, but I just did it. I just wrote it down.
And I wonder, a long time ago, I taught German, Dutch as a second language to refugees, and I noticed that you have basically two kind of people, and sometimes people felt so sad about the loss of the country, and also they felt forced to get rid of their original language, and they were not always able to do so. Did you ever feel that you had to abandon your original language, your mother tongue, or was it already in the beginning a feeling of, no, I'm adding a language, I'm not losing the old one?
Individual circumstances of every migration, forced one, and not only the circumstances but also the consequences are completely different. So I've, in my work back at home, when I talk to other refugees and when I'm teaching German, then I will find so many different answers to these questions, to mm-hmm. how language is felt emotionally. Is German being accepted, or is it being declined as a kind of a rebellious, I don't want to be part of this? Or I love these moments where you find out, when you observe how a young migrant who is learning German becomes firm and becomes self-aware in a positive way, that now he is using a language to tell his story, which I'm basically doing with my literature most of the time. So for me, I actively wanted this language. I was one of those who never felt burdened by the novelty of it, or by the grammatical gravity of it. I was always kind of urged to do something with it. And I think being privileged in a way that I grew up in a family which still, next to all the precarious living circumstances, has time for me to help me overcome being a refugee in a foreign country. They gave me space to be like that. They never forced me to do stuff. They never declined German language. They always were supportive. And so those are really, really very specific circumstances of being a refugee in a foreign country. And this is very rarely the case. We all many times have traumatic experiences. Yep. We have bad schools. We have teachers who don't care. So I had so much luck in my German learning life, so that I never really actually felt that I'm kind of throwing away the old language and then replacing it. It was always parallel to, next to each other, and that's why your first question was like that. So I'm basically actively using both for my books and kind of trying out how does this sentence sound in Serbo-Croatian. Oh, I could translate it, this and use it for the book. So it's still both there, and I still both actively love it.
Maybe this is a good moment for both of you to read something to see how this turned out.
So we prepared, Anna-Marie prepared, Anna-Marie prepared some fragments. Should I, or do you want
to? Yeah, you can read in German, then I read in Dutch, and I can tell why I chose.
Good. So this first fragment is about my grandmother. She had dementia at the end of her life, and most of the time she did not know where she was or who she was or who we are. And this little passage, this little fragment is actually from her time when she was still fit, when she was still this powerful old lady. And she wanted me to visit a small village where the family of my grandfather comes from. Großmutter stand, umgezogen, hinter mir. Schwarze Bluse, schwarze Stoffhose, nur die Gummistiefel. Die waren gelb. Ich musste an Supergirl denken, das sein Kostüm anlegt, in Sekundenschnelle. Nur war das Haar meiner Großmutter nicht lang und blond, sondern Dauerwelle und lila. Und sie trug ein Trauercape. Wo willst du hin? Wir fahren nach Oskarusche. Ja, ich bin doch gerade erst angekommen. Das Ankommen kann warten. Oskarusche hat das Warten satt. Ein Hupen. Der Fahrer, der ist auch schon da. Sie band sich das schwarze Kopftuch unterm Kinn, begutachtete ihr Spiegelbild, nahm es wieder ab. Hör zu, sagte sie. Es ist zum Schämen, dass du noch nie da oben warst. Es ist zum Schämen. Und als ich mich immer noch nicht rührte, das Zögern hat noch nie eine gute Geschichte erzählt. Ich weiß nicht, woher sie das hatte, aber es klang verdammt gut. Wie lange bleiben wir? Fragte ich. Ist man einmal oben, will man für immer bleiben. Im Gang standen Tüten voller Lebensmittel. Die hatte wohl ihr Polizist vorbeigebracht. Jetzt sollte ich sie tragen. Großmutter lächelte mich an. Willkommen zu Hause, sagte sie, mein Esel.
Thank you. And now we will see the translation that you made.
Okay. Grootmoeder stond achter me. Ze had zich omgekleed. Zwarte blouse, zwarte broek. Alleen haar leren laarzen waren geel. Ik moest aan Supergirl denken, die haar kostuum binnen een paar seconden aantrekt. Alleen was het haar van mijn grootmoeder niet lang en blond, maar gepermanent en paars. En ze droeg een rouwkepel. Waar ga je heen? We gaan naar Oskarusha. Ik ben net aangekomen. Dat aankomen kan wachten. Oskarusha heeft lang genoeg gewacht. Er klonk getoeter. De chauffeur is er ook al. Ze knoopte haar zwarte hoofddoek vast onder haar kin, bekeek zichzelf in de spiegel, deed hem weer af. Hoor eens, zei ze. Je zou je kapot moeten schamen dat je nog nooit boven bent geweest. En toen ik me nog steeds niet verroerde, uit aarzelen is nog nooit een goed verhaal voortgekomen. Geen idee waar ze dat vandaan had, maar dat klonk goed. Hoe lang blijven we daar? Als je eenmaal boven bent, wil je er voor altijd blijven. In de gang stonden zakken met eten. Die was haar politieman zeker komen brengen. Nu moest ik ze dragen. Grootmoeder glimlachte naar me. Welkom thuis, zei ze, ezeltje van me.
Dank.
Okay, I wrote some things down why I chose this fragment. It's the lightness in the fragment that touches me. It's the originality of the language. You say, uit aarzelen is nog nooit een goed verhaal voortgekomen. You don't know if it's a sentence of Sasha himself, or is it a sentence from your grandmother? If it's your sentence, it's quite funny. When you say, I don't know where she got that from, but it sounded good. Verdammt good. So there's always this lightness and the severity at the same time. So grandmother is alone, she's a widow, she lives alone, she lives not yet in the past, but almost. She misses her grandson, I assume. Mm-hmm. She has been waiting for you, probably. it's one of the last moments that she hasn't begun to forget things, and she wants to show Sasha where he comes from before it's too late. So it's a hilarious piece, a set at the same time, and that's something that comes back in the whole novel. Yeah. Hilarious parts, sad parts. That's what I love.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great part to choose and to explain why you chose it, because that's really something that strikes the reader, that you have this these different layers of melancholy and lightheartedness that go very fluently together. I remember myself a chapter that is called Gasten, in which you write, I think, about some the shame you felt as a young schoolboy because of the furniture that your parents had in the house, and of course there wasn't a lot of money. And you also write very tenderly and very movingly about your wish and your parents' wish to be able to have a guest in the house, to have the friends of you, their son, in the house, or the parents of this friend, to have a dinner at their house. And this never happens. And I've always remembered this as a very moving part. You clearly pay a lot of attention to that element of having to leave your country, and also maybe a loss of dignity.
Exactly. My parents were my mother especially was. I don't know a person on this earth who is as much as Gastgeber. I don't know. Do you have the word?
Yeah. Gastfrei.
Gastfrei. A host for people like her. Yeah. And when we came to Germany, there was something that she was missing. She had to work long times. We did not have the money. We were all kind of ashamed because we didn't have space and furniture or whatever. So the most of the time, the people who came to all of us were Bosnian, Serbian friends who were living in the neighborhood. And that didn't feel like guests. They were like, the door was open, so they would just be there and eat our food. So, And then at some point, like after maybe a year and a half or so, I was trying to get my own friends to come to visit me. And and they would gladly come, but it was on me to invite them, to say, so now you can come. Because at this age, I was like turning 16 or 15 and a half, and I don't know, I was the world champion in puberty, I think. There was nothing in my life I would have loved to do more than to be kind of against my parents. So some of my ideas were, if they can't have guests but would like them, I would have guests. But I was ashamed too. So it was really a complete disaster, actually. Then I met a girl, and she came into our life, and she was suddenly always there, which was really nice for everyone, and she kind of opened the door. Mm-hmm. And now I was thinking, now 20 years later or so, how this must be a defining moment, the shame in the life of many other refugees, how this not having your things, not being able to go to buy something, it doesn't even have to be new, but your choice, or even, like, there was such a detail that my mother always said, I hated that we are eating with different kinds of spoon, and the spoon was one kind and the fork was the other one and the knife was the trigger, because there was just stuff that somebody gave us. So remember, from her first paycheck, she bought this because that was important for her, to have the same kind of cheap, this is something that makes her feel more at home, maybe, I don't know. And it's completely legitimate, no matter how absurd it was. So that was, I thought, something that might be interesting for the conversation about how being a guest, but an honest guest, not a guest You know, in Germany we have these dinners where you would invite a refugee for an evening. It's like a you know, like this zoological project. So okay, he comes one day, he hears our German food, which is kind of nice. And but no, to be invited somewhere because you met somebody and you understood each other and you found each other interesting, and so that's something that really took time, a lot of time, and it was really important for us all. So that's why I'm describing it in this detail also.
In the book, this visit never takes place. Yeah. They have not been able to be that kind of host that they so much wanted to be. Has that changed?
Yes, a lot. My parents moved to the U.S. after that. 1998, there was a brief time where our stay in Germany was canceled, so we had to leave the country. I could stay. I'm describing it in the book because there was a guy at the Foreign Office who helped me to stay, but my parents had to leave. And in the States, they found very much faster their grounds, found better jobs, had friends, American friends, Bosnian friends, and had on this social level and on the level of self esteem a much better life than in. So I was kind of glad when I visited them. Everything was, you know, they even managed to buy an apartment. I don't know, this is material stuff, but still, that matters a lot for my father and my mother. So, yes, they had, after leaving Germany, they had a good life.
Too bad for Germany, I would say. Yeah. Still, your book is not an accusation of Germany. It stays in that way. It's not overtly political. But do you feel that countries should change their ways of dealing with refugees? I read one of your tweets, because you are active on Twitter, and you were particularly angry, and I completely understood why, about the language that was used to describe how countries deal with the arrival of refugees, and you are very.
They changed it afterwards.
They did. Maybe you can.
I love being in a position that I'm like this famous writer, and then I can complain about something, and then they change it.
And they change it.
It's like yes. Yeah. Well, of course. I mean, the book is political in a way that I'm trying to give an examples of what I believe works and what I believe doesn't work. And what I believe in the 90s, where Yugoslavia fell apart and people from the Balkans came to Germany, I'm putting parallels to the 2050, 2060, where refugees from other places are coming to in big numbers. And I'm trying to compare the discourse, which is still full of clichés, against the refugees. I'm comparing the restrictions in the politics and saying you cannot expect people to integrate when you never let give them the feeling that they are welcomed here, and many, many other things. So the book is political, but on a very personal level, because I'm always trying to find examples in my education, which I find really relevant for the discussions about migration, in my social life, and also in the way how politics and media dealt with this. And of course, I'm completely aware that there are problems connected with being a country who has to deal with a large number of refugees, like Germany had to do with the last 3 years. But if we are honest to ourselves, we managed to do it very well. And still people are being pushed away in countries that there is no peace right now. Still there are problems in we have a right-wing party in our parliament. I mean, you know what I'm talking about here too. So there is still so much to do, and I do understand my book as an offer, as a constructive dialogue offer to say, this is what I believe might help to even you know, consider a school system which, in my case and the case of my friends, helped us not feel overwhelmed and not feel ausgegrenzt, like pushed away from the. So there's so much running. I'm noticing it in a school where my son is, which is a school which almost has no migrants. I'm reading to the kids in another school with a high migrant number, And when you compare them, how much money the school has where my son is going, and how little money the other school has, and all the, it's just so, it's really, it bothers me that it's so unfair that people, that children are being educated on two different levels. Mm-hmm. And my kid is profiting from it, because we, by coincidence, are, you know, like 100 meters to the right side of the street. And we, so there is so much going wrong, and I consider myself more a political person when it comes to deal with it in reality as a citizen of Germany than in my writing, because if I'm too moral about it, then it becomes some kind of Gebrauchsanweisung. It's like you push people too much. You know, look how, and so I'm trying to hide some things in it, but I'm not really pushing towards an agenda in a way. Sorry, that was a long answer.
No, but it was interesting. It was an interesting and great answer, yeah. You said at the beginning of your long answer that you love the power you have now, or that you are an accomplished writer who can say things on Twitter and change things. And I can imagine that, you've written your book, but you want to read other people to read it as well. At the beginning of this talk, you spoke highly about translations. So is that the importance of translating in there for you as well, that you can broaden your power?
That's another personal
world power. Domination.
Netherlands. No, but we are sitting here because there is translation. We all are here because of that. And by trying to educate myself in literature, I'm trying to read authors from all parts of the world. And I just simply banally would not be able to do so if there were not people like Anne-Marie. And translation is for me a personal win for my stories, because I want them to be read widely, and especially in Europe, when you have when we talk about problems that I'm describing here, these problems are everywhere in Europe. If you talk about Italy, Netherlands, they are specific to each country, but still you can, I believe, objectivize them, and then this make that. So what Anne-Marie does and what translators do with books like this, they open the doors to to pull out our stories. And even more so if the story has like the second step, if the story comes from even a second country. So I am bringing stories from Yugoslavia to Germany, put them in German. And so Anne-Marie is actually taking two steps into Netherlands and helping this book and me and those stories. Because those stories, as you just mentioned in this little part, are not only the stories of my family. Of course, I put so much research and work and spoke to many migrant families to be able to see more than only myself in my biography. And all of this is now here. So it's a really like a banal building bridges between our experiences, and you as readers come in with your own experiences and get enriched by translation. And it's such a beautiful process. I mean, if you think about it, how much effort it takes and how many steps it takes. And in the end, you have a world in your hands, and it's in a different language, and it's still kind of ours. So.
That's magic, yeah. Beautifully said.
But also, I want to take power in Netherlands. Yes.
Rule the world.
Sorry, just one second. This is really actually important for me, because now the Greens might come to power in Germany, and I've been in contact with them for years now. So now I have contact in high places, and when they were doing this consolidation talks, and there was no migrant in them. So I actually have the email address of one of them, and I've written, why do you not have migrants? And then oh my God! So there's actively, it's so great, to have a little bit of, open eyes and ears for to make people aware that they are again, we are the Green Party, we are liberal, we are left. And then they forget to put a migrant person in there.
Quite an important.
So where is why are you doing this? And so this is something that makes me really kind of, I'm already looking to, I'm like this annoying person, which will, right. So just sorry.
I think it's important.
So in that sense, what does the European Prize for Literature mean for the both of you?
Oh.
Okay, you answer first.
you would have tomorrow. You have actually you're missing out a musical performance because of the prize. So this is
yes, yes. But for me, it's more personally because it's a great honor for me as a translator to get rewarded because usually we're not seen, barely. Often our names aren't mentioned in a recensie.
Anyway.
So for me, this is the first time that I'm seen, and so it's more, it's a personal thing for me. It's a lot of fun because I just love I love translating in general, and I love translating Stanisic. What more can I say?
But does it help you say usually we aren't seen as translators? And I know this prize particularly pays attention to the importance of translations. And I noticed there's some discussion going on about putting the name of the translator on the cover. What's your opinion about that? Would you think that's a good idea?
It would be great. It would be nice, but not for me. Not necessary. Our names are in the book twice. It would be helpful to mention our names in the papers, in the what is a recensie?
Reviews.
Thank you. In the reviews, because the 1st of September we got the prize, and then 2 days later there was a review from another book. There was not even my name. No. So it's kind of bizarre. One day you win a prize and next day you just don't exist.
Yeah.
So do you agree with what Sasha said earlier that the translation is
vital.
Autonomous?
Mm-hmm. Oh. Autonomous process.
Autonomous, work. I want to say work of art, but that sounds...
Yes, it was some weeks ago. I was in Leeuwarden. There was a night. It was called Vertalersgeluk, so translator's happiness. And someone asked, don't you think that you translators should be more important than the writer? Because it's your work. So you should get all the credits for it. I don't know, because we are kind of modest people.
Yes, but I agree totally with what you said. Without the work of the translators, I wouldn't have been able to read your book.
That's true, but without the book, there wouldn't be a translation at all. So.
Yeah. So that's chicken egg, egg.
Yeah, little bit.
But it's from German egg to Dutch egg.
Oh, that was something I wanted to say before, because maybe the reason that it's not that hard for me to translate. It's because German and Dutch are kind of equal. And there was this Korean translator. I don't know if you read this. All these questions in the colloquium. Mm-hmm. There was an online. Workshop with all the translators. So there was this Korean translator. He was very quick, very fast. And he or she, I don't know, asked so many questions about names. He or she said, these names, are these war criminals? And then someone else was...
very patiently answering.
Yeah, in answering all the questions. I don't know who it was.
It was one of the Goethe Institute people.
One of the Goethe Institute. No, it's... football players, soccer players. And there were all these questions from the Korean translator. And I thought, oh, this must be so hard because this translator is from another culture. This must be so difficult. But there were a lot of questions that you could just...
Google it.
Google. But still, German and Dutch, maybe it's easier for me to translate to.
And did you gain in translating? We are talking about the importance of the work of translators and translations, gaining a language instead of losing one. In translation of Sasha's work, did you also gain a bit of former Yugoslavia? Because so many things that you write about are connected with...
Yes, you have to read a lot, but that was especially the part about the Kurort.
Ah,
Visegrad,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it was not a very pleasant experience because it was about this hotel.
Rape,
raped. And then I was shocked. I was... you just have to put everything down and go for a walk because it's you don't want to read these things.
Mm-hmm. But you need them to be able to...
I need to read it because I have to picture it, I have to see it. Yeah. So then you get all these pictures and all these stories. So yes, you gain something, but it's not always easy.
That's also something that really I want to emphasize on. We talked about how translators have some sort of aesthetical freedom, and until a certain point, of course, there is a original and you want to hit it right. Mm. But I've even noticed here that some actually it sounded nicer in Dutch because the substantives were gone and there was verbs instead of that, which I like. Mm-hmm. But also, I sometimes think when I write stories like the one of Vilina Vlast, it's a place in Visegrad where during the war, women were being held and raped constantly and killed, and there is not even a little like a frame or anything remembering that. Mm-hmm. So when I write that, I'm totally conscious that I'm educating people, that I am using informations and that I'm giving them away for people to know what's happening. Because at the place itself, if you don't know about it, you go there for a swim, mm-hmm. and it's a place of horror and you know,
you can still book a room.
You can, it's just.
So I found it out, and I was crying because I couldn't believe it.
Exactly.
There's no sign. There's nothing. You can just book a room on Booking.com or I don't know. There are people going there.
So this is what I'm saying. That is like to transfer the stories from one country to another, and then another step from Germany, then to. This is something that the translation is just—it's like a process of education, and that's also what I said at the beginning when I talk to translators and they have questions about this. Then I'm gladly the one who would help, you know, to say, okay, of course you don't know the story. The story is really kept quiet, so let us talk about it because I want that to be heard and I want it to be understood and I want it to be translated. So those are the critical questions for me. When somebody comes with that and it's just. Then, as much as I worked on it and had to, you know, fight my own demons to describe it, I wanted to be thrown out into the world and to be among us. So that's really important for me.
So it's really very intensive and intimate cooperation.
Yes.
The translation of a book, and it's not.
It can be. Not all translators want it, and it's great. And the Korean translator had like 500 questions about everything. And that's okay too, but at some point you have to let go. I think also when you translate yourself, you if you have so many questions, how can you, like, it's like on every page you had like, I don't know, it's like, but maybe that's how she, I think it was she.
Yeah,
she
okay.
Maybe read?
Yeah.
One more fragment.
How are you feeling, actually? It's weird for me to see people without masks, because in Germany everybody is still with masks.
Still fully,
fully masked.
Yeah.
And this passage, it's about a bird, but also it's about... I'm at this point in the book and in the process of working on the book, I was trying to put down some things that I found out about origin, about Herkunft, that I thought might be worth of, you know, just putting them down until end of the book. Der Wendehals ist ein Höhlenbrüter. Nur der Wendehals singt so, wie der Wendehals singt. Der Wendehals ist am ruffreudigsten, wenn er sich fortpflanzt. Sein Singen besteht aus 8 bis 15 rau klingenden,
oder wird lauten. Warnungen stößt er aus Deck- oder Döpp-Silben. Meine Großmutter, die mich Esel und Sonne nennt. Meine Großmutter, die mit Pantoffeln an den Füßen schläft. Herkunft, Hervorbringung, keine Heldengeschichten. Hier in Hamburg hockend, alliterierend und Eichendorff zitierend am Samstagmorgen vor einem Familienausflug ins Wendland. Oh, du stilles, heiteres Glück. Selbstbewusstsein gegen Fremdbestimmung, auch in der Sprache. Familie, Spechtvögel, Eichendorff, mein Sohn, Twitter, die Visegrader, die Gebrüder Grimm, Computerspiele, das fucking Grimmsche Wörterbuch. Die Möglichkeiten, eine Geschichte zu erzählen, sind quasi unendlich. Da triff mal die Beste. Und? Hast du nicht noch etwas vergessen? Immerhin, immer hast du auch etwas vergessen.
Ah, de Wendehals, de Draaihals. De Draaihals is een holenbroeder. Alleen de Draaihals zingt zoals de Draaihals zingt. De Draaihals zingt het liefst tijdens de voortplanting. Zijn gezang bestaat uit 8 tot 15 rauwklinkende wiet- of weutgeluiden. In het Nederlands hetzelfde als in Duits, had ik bedacht. Ik kon het niet vinden. Waarschuwingen slaakt hij met tip of tup, tup klanken. Mijn grootmoeder, die me ezel en zonnetje noemt. Mijn grootmoeder, die met pantoffels aan haar voeten slaapt. Herkomst, herinnering, geen heldenverhalen. Hier in Hamburg hangen allitererend en Eichendorff citerend. Op zaterdagochtend voor een gezinsuitje naar het Wendland. O, jij stil en vrolijk geluk. Autonomie versus afhankelijkheid, ook in de taal. Familie, Spechten, Eichendorff, mijn zoon, Twitter, de Visegraders, de gebroeders Grimm en hun woordenboek, computerspelletjes. De mogelijkheden om een verhaal te vertellen zijn vrijwel oneindig. Vind dan maar eens de beste. En ben je niet iets vergeten? Je bent altijd wel iets vergeten.
Mooi. Du hast die Gebrüder Grimm und das Wörterbuch zusammen getan. Das
ist gut. Was?
Die Gebrüder Grimm und das Wörterbuch?
Ja, ja.
Voll gut.
Gebrüder Grimm und
macht auch Sinn.
Und ihr fucking Wörterbuch. Das war nicht in dem Buch.
Nee.
Okay.
Voll gut.
I just read aloud what I wrote down. Okay. I love passages like this. Okay. Let's look up the European wryneck to see what sounds it makes in Dutch. But it's the same. No problem, Sascha. I love playing with language, the experimental part of it. It's fun to join Sascha in his thoughts that are sometimes somewhat psychedelic. And I just wonder what kind of mushrooms did he eat? So I'm not translating just words, I'm translating a state of mind, a mood. And about this forgetting, that's the same for translating. Every word could have been another word. And didn't I miss a reference here or there? The writer forgets things, and the translator misses things. Mm. That were my thoughts.
Very beautiful. I'm
this is really nice because my Swedish translator Christine is just right now translating to this book into Swedish, and she asked me about I forgot what it was, but she asked me a very specific question, and I said, oh no, I didn't really give that too much thought. And her answer was, that's why you have me. I will give it some thought. So this was so nice. I really love that.
Well, maybe this is a good part to ask you something about the ending as well.
Yeah.
For the people who didn't read the book yet, we're not spoiling anything, but... well, first of all, read the book. But second of all, the book doesn't really has one ending. I can say that both for the writer and the translator, you cannot miss a single beat there while writing it or translating it. But how did you manage to translate it? First that, maybe, and then that's the other way around. But I'm very curious, because did you make a scheme or?
Yes, translating was not the hardest part, but all to getting the page numbers in the right place.
So maybe just for the people who didn't read it, at the end of this book, you as readers can decide where you want to read. So I give you possibilities. Yeah, possibilities. We will actually read one fragment. Yeah. Yeah. I will describe a scenery and then give you two ways how you could go out, how you would read next. So you choose your own way. Let's choose your own adventure, yeah, actually. And that was the question. So pages, that was the yeah art.
Yeah. That was a problem.
Okay.
Not because I had to wait till the final proof before I could put all the page numbers on the right place. Mm. So we had these schemes and it was kind of a puzzle.
But not a word puzzle, but
No, yeah. No. But it had to be right because
yeah, it would be sad if you choose the way.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
But there are also themes, yeah, and words are coming back. Like if you choose a certain,
yes.
So it's but
you
really
have to be very alert.
Alert, yeah.
But also, what I was curious about, it's basically another genre. It's fantastic literature. Yeah. Did you have any?
For you, not really my thing.
Okay.
But I liked it.
Because that's a different tone. There are dragons and there are elves. No elves, but like some kind of a fiend. I don't know, Wiele. I don't know what. Fairies and stuff,
yeah,
like that. So.
Dat heb ik ervan gemaakt.
We have actually. Should we just read one?
Yeah.
Little. Yeah. It's just a very short part. So this is how it looked like. Here you don't have a choice. Here is.
That's. You can read the Dutch part and then.
Do you want?
That would be fun. Next.
Yeah. No, you read first now, and then I read. No.
Oh. Yeah. Dutch. Yes. Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. So. Draken lopen al 5000 jaar op aarde rond. De oorsprong van de draken hier is te vinden in de legendarische streken van de Caucasus en Mesopotamië. Zonder de migratiebewegingen van de laatste millennia zouden er in de omgeving van Oskaroosje geen draken zijn. Maar nu horen jullie, nadat je de huurauto hebt geparkeerd en met grootmoeder bent uitgestapt, in de wolken boven jullie hoofd een machtige vleugelslag. Wat was dat? Vraagt grootmoeder. Slechts van de bergen nog ruist zacht het woud, zeg je. Grootmoeder gaapt en door je hart vaart een beving. Je legt je jas om grootmoeders schouders. Het licht in de auto gaat uit. En ook de wereld. Zaklamp app aan. En het bos door. Op pagina 305.
So here you don't have a choice. No. Normally you have another choice. So, Drachen bevölkern die Erde seit 5000 Jahren. Die Herkunft der hiesigen Drachen ist in den sagenumwogenen Gefilden des Kaukasus und Mesopotamiens zu finden. Ohne also die Migrationsbewegung der letzten Jahrtausende gäbe es in der Gegend um Oskaroosje keine Drachen. So aber hört ihr, nachdem du den Mietwagen abgestellt hast und mit Großmutter ausgestiegen bist, in den Wolken über euch einen mächtigen Flügelschlag. Was war das? Fragt Großmutter. Nur von den Bergen rauscht der Wald, sagt das Eichendorf.
Ja.
Großmutter gähnt.
Das ist dein Text, nicht mein.
Ich wollte es mal verraten. Und dich schauert im Herzensgrund. Du legst Großmutter deine Jacke über die Schultern, das Licht im Wageninneren schaltet sich aus und die Welt mit. Taschenlampen-App an und ab durch den Wald auf Seite 321.
Okay.
Thank you. I think on this note we can end the discussion talk conversation here, and ask if there are still any questions in the audience. Q&A time, and with help from with the microphone. So yeah, I can see someone.
A question for Sasha. How was your book received in the countries of former Yugoslavia?
Well, it came out in Croatia last year and Serbia this year, and they are both very different publishing houses, which was very peculiar for me. The Serbian publishing house has a really young readership, and they are very firm on Instagram and social media, and they had really nice cover. And so many young people who have social media accounts bought the book, and made those those photographs where you have like flowers and stuff around the book and the wine glass and yeah. And it was completely weird for me to have this kind of almost only on social media readers trying to tell their love for the book. Most of the time it was really love for the book. And in Croatia, it was this old Fraktura, this old publishing house, the biggest one there, and their readership is much older. They didn't do anything in social media at all. So, and the book was widely discussed in newspapers, even on TV, because the audience and the readers were much older. And so it's kind of, for me, it's really like two different worlds. And I'm really glad about both of them. That's how they work, I guess. But I was more curious about Serbia, because the book is not easy on the Serbian part of the Balkan War, on the nationalist Serbian part of the Balkan War. So I was kind of a little bit afraid also how the reception would be. But this new generation of readers there at least seem not to care or even to be glad to read literature that did give them different perspectives. So there was a really benevolent and very nice reception on this level. But on Instagram, so, and I'm very glad because I believe this publishing house is really young and really small, and it was for them, it was kind of a success, but you know, they don't sell many books, but I think they had a success with it, and I'm very glad about it. So, but you cannot expect like a broad discussion about it, there's just too few readers there, and books are literature itself, it's not considered anymore like, you know, this affirmative power in culture. It's just, you know, it just disappears after a while and nobody talks about those books anymore. So, but I was glad that it's there. So.
Didn't they want to appropriate you when they say this is our guy?
This was before.
Happen before?
With the first book.
In Croatia or in Serbia? Or
in all three countries and in different ways because, just for a small explanation, my family is ethnically mixed. I have a Serbian father and a Bosniak mother. But that never played a role in our family. But when my first book came out in Germany and was translated, everybody was kind of surprised because that was something that was just starting to happen. Alexander Hammon and me, were kind of, you know, those writers not writing in their own language, well, in the first language. So what happened is, in Germany, everybody thought of me as a Bosnian writer who coincidentally writes in German. So there was like a side note, he writes in German. Yeah. In Bosnia, like the Bosnians are, they did as if I wrote the book originally in Bosnian. So I was with the other Bosnian writers, you know, because they sell better. So they just did not care that I wrote the German. They did as if it was not a translation. I was within the in Serbia, they didn't even want to publish it because it was so political at first. And then a publishing house came later and published it. So, and for them, I was a Serbian writer suddenly because I have a Serbian name. And, you know, if I'm honest, it's a very productive space to be as a writer that everybody wants you to be something else. You know, in Germany, they want you to be this migrant author, they are enriching our culture. In Bosnia, they want you to be a Bosnian author because he's winning the prizes. And you know, I just want to tell my stories, and I simply don't care. So it's if they want to see me like that, it's their own. They have to explain it, not me. And it's a productive space to be because you know I can answer questions like this and make kind of fun of. Zuschreibung of this Fremdbestimmung, that was the word in the one text, when somebody else decides who you are, yeah. A big problem in the Balkans, but big problem in Europe too. And literature is not free of that. And I'm not talking about migrant literature only. In Germany, we have those discussions when a young woman writes a book and they are like complete, like they always want to. Oh, the young woman wrote a book. It is probably this kind of book. So, and it's not that kind of book. So there's all those kind of people, prejudices, yeah, old white men telling you who you are. So
that's a shitty thing about identity.
Yes.
I would like to ask something about the translation. You read it, this passage, you read it in Dutch first, and I don't really remember how you did it. In German, you say, this is Eichendorff, and
as you say it, I can recognize that the language is different. So for German readers, you see, nur von den Bergen rauschet der Wald. It's very old-fashioned. And dich schauert im Herzensgrunde. It's very clear that it's not your normal language. So I would like to perhaps to repeat the Dutch. How did you do that? The difference.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it's always about a translator. You have to recognize things. So I have to recognize this is a poem. This is something from Eichendorff. So there were some poets before in the book. So probably these sentences are from the other. I'm not quite sure.
I think one is from already mentioned book poem, and the other one is a new one.
Yeah. Okay. So I don't know if these translations are mine or from someone else. I think I translated them myself, but. Machtige Vleugelslag, was that?
This is for me.
Yeah. Okay. there was a stille Vleugelslag before in the book. So this was the mighty. So you just have to recognize the poems, the references. Oh. Mm-hmm. I don't know what was that.
Yeah. Thank you, Val.
I didn't read the book, but it was very interesting to see these translations, and I thought the Dutch was far sweeter than the German, actually. It really had a different atmosphere.
You probably bring your personality in the translation, but I think Sasha has a very sweet personality as well. So, I don't know.
Could it be the language, maybe?
Maybe. Yeah.
Well, for example, you said Ezeltje.
I'm just thinking, how would this grandmother?
Interestingly enough, there is when I was my grandmother used to tell Magarche, so it is actually a diminutive form, but in German Magarche Eselchen sounds very very strange. Eselchen, I always thought it might be funnier if my grandmother calls me Esel, which is kind of a. It's not nice. Esel are great animals, but you don't want to be called Esel. So actually, without knowing, I think she did it more correct way. But
somewhere else I have Esel, so I'm not very consequent in that. But in Dutch, it's quite normal to
I think we might have time for one more question, and then. It's maybe time to go for a drink.
So I read the book, and I'm still one of the things I'm still thinking about, and it resonated a little bit in what you said, was the relationship to storytelling, and I think. You know, you talked a little bit about the lightness, and some part of the lightness for me came from what I think is maybe a specific, you know, for Yugoslavia, former Yugoslavia, specific relationship to storytelling that is not necessarily part of German culture in the same way. And I'm speaking about from a bi-national background. So my father was born in Bosnia in 1933, and so I had this weird experience of recognizing something in the way you told the story and the way you played with like differences. It doesn't have to be authentic and it's still true and you can play with it and you change it, and next time you tell the story it might be a little bit different and it's still, you know, it still has the same importance. And so I kind of suddenly recognized something that I'd never thought about,
that I experienced in the storytelling of my father. But we didn't have a discourse on that. It was just part of, yeah. you know, how we communicated. So my question, I guess, the thing is, in how far, so do you recognize that? And what kind of importance, if so, what kind of an importance does that have for your writing in this book, but maybe also generally?
That's actually a really great question, because I was asking myself the same. Do I perform a kind of a cultural storytelling style or process in how I tell the stories? Did I take something from my childhood and how I was told stories into my writing today? And I believe so, yes. But I could not kind of frame it by an example. But what happens often in the readings, that people from the former Yugoslavia come to me afterwards and say, you know, we have a similar story like you told. We tell it a little bit differently, and then they will tell you the story. So keep with all the Germans waiting. They have the time to tell you. And there is, I don't know, there should be somebody who should kind of examine it. But I strongly believe that there is something, a kind of a heritage that we give on to the next generation via storytelling. With heritage, I don't mean only the information that we give, but also how we tell, how we provide those information. And you've mentioned one of those things is the humor. And you know, no matter, when I think back to the stories of my childhood, no matter how sad the times were, there was always laughter in these gatherings. There was always some lightness that you mentioned. So I'm really not an esoteric person, but I believe unconsciously I've taken that with me, with my how I talk to my child, how I tell my stories. Sometimes I want to be funny, so I would, you know, think, what kind of joke can I put in here? So that's something very actively mine. But sometimes I'm not even trying, and there is in the story. And especially, if you remember in the book, when I'm talking about the older parts of my family, my grand-grandparents, and then we had a little, just few information, so I had to pull the story together from my own, you know, authorship, and those little information. And there, I had the feelings that I'm using, because these are old stories of my grandfather, I kind of had a feeling, oh, I'm kind of not myself here. There's something in this. I'm trying to, you know, to put all mythological things, humor, and everything what I kind of brought to my life, through my life as a child, I'm using it now, actively. So there is probably something there, but somebody should take a look in my brain and see what parts activate when I tell a story. And I can completely take it out. My second novel is in Brandenburg, and I completely can be very serious and can you know kind of turn it off. But for this world, I don't need to turn it off. So there is something recognizable in it.
Yeah, and it's definitely a part of origin of herkomst. This storytelling and the way. In which these stories are told. Sasha, thank you very, very much for answering these questions and talking about your book. It was wonderful. And Anne-Marie, also thank you with your notes on translation. This is very informative and interesting to hear your thoughts about that. Thank the audience for listening and asking great questions. And let's go for a little booze, piece of liquid.